Hello everyone, this is SMD Mazharul Haq, Assistant Professor, Deputy Department, ISL Engineering College. I am doing the subject Electrical Measurements and Instrumentation, and today's topic is about Maximum Demand Indicator and Frequency Meter. So what is a Maximum Demand Indicator? The Maximum Demand Indicator measures the maximum amount of power required by the consumer at a particular interval of time. The indicator is designed in such a way that they measure the base and peak load, but they are unable to measure the sudden short circuit or high current to the motor. It is designed for recording the power over particular periods. So what is a maximum demand indicator? It is a indicating instrument, or it is a instrument that records and as well as indicates both things are happening in the same instrument, and it is designed for recording the power over a particular time period. So suppose we are having some time periods, like in 24 hours we are having some 0 to 5 hours or 5 to 10 hours, like that. For a particular period of time, we will be having the power recorded. So how many types are there? The maximum demand indicators are classified into 4 types. One is recording demand indicator, and second is average demand indicator, and third is thermal type maximum demand indicator, and the fourth one is digital maximum demand indicator. So let us see now what is this construction of maximum demand indicator has, and the maximum demand indicator has how many parts. So in general we are having, these are 4. One is the pointer, the reset device, the fraction device, and the indicating pin. So let us see that how this is happening. Average demand indicator. The average demand indicator is inbuilt into the energy meter, and the energy meter and the average demand indicator together measure the total power consumed and the maximum value of specific power at particular interval of the time. The average demand indicator consists of the complex speed dial mechanism. What does it consist of? It consists of the complex speed dial mechanism. So if you see this MERS price maximum demand indicator, you are having this particular thing where you will be having a cam, and you will be having a pinion, a spring here, the bell crank mechanism will be there, a pointer, and a pin. So these are the mechanisms of the MERS price maximum demand indicator. Now let us see how this is going to work. So the pin drive moves the dial forward for small duration, say for half an hour, and the total power consumed at the interval is shown on the dial. So what is the dial here? This is the dial which is having the recording that is shown whenever this particular thing is being in use. So what happens is the total power consumed at interval is shown on a dial, and the instrument consists of the cam which is controlled by timing gears. The cam brings the pointer at zero positions, and the pointer records the total power consumed by the load at the particular interval of time. For the next half an hour, the pin again moved forward, but the pointer will move forward only when the total power consumed by the load is more than the previous periods. The formula here calculates the average maximum demand, and this average maximum demand as well as maximum demand are very much essential to calculate the load on the particular consumer, because how much load is using and how much demand is using, what is the tariff there, you have to plan for it. For it requires maximum demand indicator is very much useful in the utility companies. So now let us see the formula for this. The maximum demand meter can measure the power regarding kVAr hour or kVA hour also. Whereas energy meter was measuring kWh, and here in the maximum demand meter is measuring kVAr or kVAh also. This can be done by adding the suitable meter which will calculate such quantities. So here maximum demand meter, kVAr means reactive power, kVA means here the power measured by the transformer. The power that is utilized by the transformer is kVA, and therefore kVA were nothing but how much energy is being used by the transformer. This can be done by adding suitable meter which will calculate such quantities. Average maximum demand in kilowatts, if you want, then maximum energy recorded over a time in interval divided by time intervals in hour is nothing but the average maximum demand in kilowatts. So it is simple to say the ratio of maximum energy recorded over a time in interval kWh divided by time intervals in hours gives you the average maximum demand in kilowatts. The advantages of average demand indicator. So what are the advantages? The average demand indicator has high accuracy. The instrument has uniform measuring scale also. Uniform has, instrument has uniform measuring scale, whereas it doesn't have a non-uniform scale, but it is using the uniform scale where accuracy is very high. For a non-uniform scale, the accuracy will be low. So the disadvantages of maximum demand indicator. Now, as the advantages we have studied, the same way disadvantages are also there for maximum demand indicator. And the first disadvantage is the cost of instrument is very high. The cost of instrument is very high. Their construction is very complicated. And nowadays, the cam is replaced by electromagnetic relay and clutch that replaces the bell crank releasing device. So here, the disadvantage is this one. And what is the frequency measurement? So how do you calculate the frequency measurement? It is the most necessary need for measurement in AC power systems designed to run efficiently. So what is the frequency measurement? It is nothing but it is a quantity that is used to measure in the AC power system design to run efficiently. Frequency measurement can be done using frequency meter. So we have a frequency meter also. We have studied till now maximum demand indicator, and now we are studying about the frequency measurement. How does a frequency measurement can be done by using a frequency meter? Now it is done for periodic electrical signals also. There are two types of deflection meters. One is electric resonance circuit, other is the ratio meter. Now we are talking about the types of frequency meter. The first frequency meter, it is having, first thing is classified into electrical resonance frequency meter. The other one is Western frequency meter and the ratio meter type frequency meter. So altogether frequency meter is classified into three: electrical resonance frequency meter, Western frequency meter and ratio type frequency meter. An electrical resonance frequency meter is again classified into ferrodynamic type frequency meter and electrodynamometer type frequency meter. Now, electrical resonance type frequency meter. The electrical resonance type frequency meter is an indicating type instrument. As the name suggests, it acts depend upon the electrical resonance. So, electrical resonance, you might have heard the term. The electrical resonance type frequency meter is an indicating type instrument where, as the name suggests, it acts depend upon the electrical resonance concept. Now the construction of electrical resonance type frequency meter. How can we construct this electrical resonance type frequency meter? So it mainly consists of a fixed coil and a moving coil. So there is a laminated iron core of varying cross section here. So you can see that there is a varying cross section as well, and you are having a fixed coil and a moving coil. As usual with all the meters, you are having a fixed coil and moving coil energy meter also. The same thing, you are having a fixed coil and moving coil in a resonance type frequency meter also. So this varying laminated core holds a fixed coil at its one end, and then we connect this fixed coil across the supply mains. So if you are doing like this, this fixed coil is one way and other one is a supply given. Now if you see here the moving coil and the fixed coil, the fixed coil is given the supply and the moving coil is connected to a capacitor. So you can see here that normal frequency as well as lower frequency and higher frequencies are there, and here the pointer is given to you. Now we'll tell that with this construction and working, the electrical resonance type frequency meter measures the frequency of these supply mains. Now there is a moving coil which is provided, which is also pivoted at its top end. So this is the nothing but it is a moving coil, and it is top end, it is pivoted here, and therefore it can move along the extended core of the fixed coil like a pendulum. Like this pendulum, it can move like this. Okay, this moving coil can move like a pendulum. The pointer of the instrument is so at the top end of the moving coil that its tip only moves along the semicircular dial. The semicircular dial is there, no? When it is moving like a pendulum here, then what happens? This pointer will be deflecting in its only in semicircle here. Now we connect and capacitor across the two leads of the moving coil. So these are the two leads of the moving coil where we are connecting a capacitor here. So this is the construction of that particular frequency meter, resonance type, and a ferrodynamic type frequency meter. It has a laminated core on which the magnetizing coil is fixed, as well as it is also having a moving coil attached to the laminated core, which is movable also. There is another terminal of the moving coil and connected to the capacitor of a suitable value. So then further the pointer is attached to the measuring scale, and we can see that how this working principle of electrodynamic resonance type frequency meter occurs. So what we have seen is the electrodynamometer type, which is one of the types of the electrical resonance type frequency meter. Now coming to the working principle of electrical resonance type frequency meter. Due to the current in the moving coil produces a flux in phase with the current. This flux flows along with the extended core of the fixed coil, and therefore the flux links the moving coil, and hence the flux induces an EMF across the moving coil. Obviously, this induced EMF lags the flux by 90 degrees. So what you have to understand here is, due to the current in moving coil produces a flux in phase with the current. Okay, in phase with the current, there is a flux produced. This flux flows along with the extended core of fixed coil. Therefore, the flux links the moving coil. Hence, the flux induces an EMF across the moving coil, and therefore, these are in 90 degrees to each other. Since it is a coil, the moving coil will have inductive reactance, and it is connected across a capacitor. It will also have some capacitive reactance also. So the circuit on the left side of this diagram, what you have seen, it has both inductive and capacitive reactances. So the torque equation, how to calculate torque equation is considered I1 is the supply current of fixed coil and I2 is the induced current of the moving coil. Now we have already mentioned that the phase angle between supply current I1, the current in fixed coil, and the EMF induced in the moving coil is 90 degrees. Again, there is a phase difference between the induced EMF and the induced current I2. So current in the moving coil, let us consider the angle of this phase difference is alpha. So the actual phase difference between I1 and I2 will be 90 degrees minus alpha, and therefore the torque equation is given by I1 I2 into cos 90 minus alpha. From the above expression of the torque, we can see that the torque will be 0 when alpha is 0. So that means that there must not be any phase difference between the induced current and the induced EMF of the moving coil. So this says that the torque equation has a current I1 and I2, as well as the supply current is I1 and the I2 is the induced current of the moving coil. Now we already mentioned that the phase angle between supply current I1 is the fixed coil and the EMF induced in the moving coil is 90 degrees. Again, there is a phase difference between the induced EMF and therefore the induced current is I2. So let us consider the angle of this phase difference is alpha. So the actual phase difference between the I1 I2 will be 90 degrees minus alpha, and T is proportional to I1 I2 into cos 90 minus alpha. So when here you are seeing that this I1 and I2 will be playing a major role here, where there must not be any phase difference between induced current and induced EMF of the moving coil. So torque will be 0 when alpha is 0, because 90 here cos 90 is 0. Here the resonance can be very much useful for the electrical electronics applications as well as very physics applications also. We have seen that this resonance can be possibly applied anywhere depending upon the particular thing where you will be using this resonance. So resonance concepts like resonance frequency meter is there, where you are having this frequency meter used. This resonance nothing but an XL is equals to XC, where the capacitive reactance is equal to the negative inductive reactance, then the resonance can be occur. So how this resonance occurs? So XL is equal to XC. What happens is that the frequency of the inductive reactance and the frequency of the inductive capacitance, then both are matching each other, then this resonance may occur. So what happens when the resonance occurs? That depends upon the angular position of the moving coil. Here we have seen that moving coil as well as the fixed coil is there. So depending upon the angular position of the moving coil, the extended core of the fixed coil is also there. So we can just switch on the supply, the fixed coil starts attracting the moving coil towards it, and therefore we can see a resonance application there, where you can see the moving coil and fixed coil are in operation, and therefore it will be possible to see that the frequency meter is measuring the proper supply frequency, as well as when this resonance occurring stage to the concept of resonance occurring stage here is explained very well, that the resonance frequency meter will measure the accurate frequency whenever you are given some supply to the terminals of the frequency meter. So what happens when the digital meter is used? So digital frequency meter here, the analog signals will be transferred to the digital signals, and therefore the digital signals will be making the display, and the going to the display, and the display will show the readings of the frequency meter, where the calibration will also be done for both digital meters as well as the analog frequency meters. In that, it is caused when XL is equals to XC. And what is this the purpose of this resonance? Talking about the resonance here in the meters means it is the resonance that can only be possible when inductive reactance of the moving coil becomes equal to its capacitor reactance. Again, the inductive reactance 2 pi FL depends upon the angular position of the moving coil on the extended core of the fixed coil. So we can say that when we just switch on the supply, the fixed coil starts attracting the moving coil towards it. So what is this main thing here to be discussed is, when the inductive reactance 2 pi FL depends upon the angular position of the moving coil on the extended core of the fixed coil, what happens is, so when just switch on the supply, the fixed coil start attracting the moving coil towards it. So at that point of time, what is there means there will be no torque acting on the moving system. When there is no torque acting on the moving system, when the torque is zero of the electrical resonance type frequency meter, therefore the pointer of the instrument becomes stationary at that point. If somehow the supply frequency changes, the value of the inductive reactance of the instrument also changes here. So when the torque is zero and the electrical resonance type frequency meter is measuring the zero is having the reading, the instrument becomes stationary at that point. If somehow the supply frequency changes, the value of inductive reactance of the instrument also changes. So here, depending upon the inductive and capacitive reactances, the frequency is also changing here. Therefore, the resonance of the circuit gets disturbed, and again the deflecting torque appears on the moving system and tries to rotate it. Therefore, hence again the inductive reactance of moving coil changes, and after certain rotation, the resonance occurs. And here the torque again becomes zero. When the resonance occurs, the torque becomes zero, and therefore you will see that the moving coil is attracted towards the fixed coil. Therefore, the pointer rests at new position now. We have seen how the position of the pointer and dial of electrical resonance type frequency meter changes with changing the supply frequency. So we'll talk about the calibration now. What is a calibration? A calibration is nothing but we have to make the instrument in such a way that it measures the equipment with reading with accuracy. So with accuracy it should measure, so it is well calibrated when it is measuring with accuracy. If it is not calibrated, then it is not measured with accuracy. We can find the exact position of the pointer tip on the dial and make it the pointer dial had 50 hertz. So that is calibration. First data we are making to measure at 50 hertz, and then what we do is we slowly increase supply frequency step by step and see that the position of at each steps, and we mark these positions of the pointer and dial with the corresponding supply frequencies. Then we reduce the supply frequency step by step and mark the corresponding positions of the pointer and the dial with corresponding frequencies. Here we can say that it is now well calibrated because we are making a standard reading of 50 hertz at the beginning, and later when we are increasing the supply frequency, when the corresponding supply frequencies, we are calibrating it. So increase supply frequency step by step and see the position at each step, and these positions should be marked so that we can say that it is well calibrated. Now measurement of frequency, when we connect the leads of the fixed coil of an electrical resonance type frequency meter with the supply mains, the position of the pointer on the dial indicates the actual frequency of the supply signal. As we have seen the diagram, which is having a fixed dial, a fixed thing and a moving coil, where a fixed coil is attracting the moving coil, and therefore whenever we have connected the supply, it actually shows the 50 hertz frequency. Whatever the supply frequency we have connected, it will show there. So students, I would like to end my topic here, and in this topic we have studied about the various electrical measurement and instruments, like we have seen about the frequency meter as well as the maximum demand indicator. The maximum demand indicator, we have learned that when the maximum demand occurs, how to measure the maximum demand as well as how to make the indicating instrument measure it with accuracy. And therefore, we are having number of in maximum demand indicators, average maximum demand indicator and maximum demand indicator also. And we are having several companies and which are making these maximum demand indicators. And even as the world has digitalized now, we are using the digitalized maximum demand meters also. And coming to the frequency meter, as we know that the frequency meter is a very essential meter which is used to measure the frequency. So with accuracy of the frequency has to do a lot of things with this particular power electronic equipments as well as this power system equipments. So the power electronic equipments which deal with the frequency, that is AC quantities like cyclo converter, has to do much with the frequency, and therefore the frequency meter measuring with accuracy is a good boon to the society where we are carrying out many power electronic activities here in the companies. So we can say that the maximum demand indicator and frequency meter are the good measuring instruments, and we see that these measuring instruments are now also in a new era. We are having a digital meters, which are digital frequency meter is there, as well as this frequency meter also there. And we are having a Western type, Western type frequency meter, where you will be having this particular frequency meter measuring the frequency, and also called as synchroscope also. So it is very important topic, Western type synchroscope. In the next class, we will discuss about the Western type synchroscope and other measuring instruments. Thank you.